TAG TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Surabhi Sharma. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Tuesday, the 10th of March. India evacuates 58 pilgrims from coronavirus-hit Iran. U.S. strongly opposed to creation of parallel Afghan government, says Pompeo. And people across India and Nepal celebrate Festival of Colours. And now for all the details. A military transport aircraft of the Indian Air Force brought back 58 Indians from coronavirus-hit Iran on Tuesday. The aircraft was sent to Tehran on Monday. Meanwhile, six fresh cases of coronavirus were reported on Tuesday, increasing the national toll to 45.
The first batch of 58 Indian pilgrims who had been stuck in Iran, one of the worst coronavirus-hit nations, arrived at the Hindon Air Force Station in northern Ghaziabad city on Tuesday morning. Indian Air Force C-17 Globemaster transport aircraft had departed for Tehran on Monday to evacuate its citizens from Iran. The passengers that arrived will be quarantined in a special facility set up in Ghaziabad city, 31 miles from capital New Delhi. It is the second such evacuation by C-17 Globemaster in the last 2 weeks. About 2,000 Indians are living in Iran. According to latest reports, 237 people have died of novel coronavirus in Iran, while the number of positive cases stands at around 7,000. Meanwhile, India reported six fresh cases of coronavirus on Tuesday, increasing the national toll to 45, as the deadly virus continues to intensify across the globe, rattling governments and investors.
Activists and political experts during an event held in Geneva discussed how Pakistan has been promoting cross-border terrorism. They highlighted Pakistan has been sheltering various terrorist groups for its proxy war against its neighboring India and Afghanistan.
Political experts and human rights activists accused Pakistan of promoting cross-border terrorism in India and Afghanistan during an event held recently in Geneva. Titled International Seminar on Cross-Border Terrorism and Human Security, the event was focused on ways to prevent trans-border and transnational terrorism. Activists highlighted how Pakistan is sheltering various terrorist groups as part of its foreign policy tactic and its proxy war against neighboring India and Afghanistan.
You cannot have peace neither in Afghanistan nor in Pakistan until you contain Pakistan and stop their cross-border terrorism activities. Pakistan's military and its notorious spy agency, ISI, is systematically involved in these cross-border terrorism activities.
The speakers also laid emphasis on how Islamic fundamentalists in Pakistan are brainwashing the civilians and instigating them to be part of jihad or holy war. Pakistan continues to remain on grey list of the Financial Action Task Force for failing to control funding to terrorist groups like the Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed, responsible for series of attacks in India.
Moving on, during the 43rd session of UNHRC in Geneva, political activists from Gilgit-Baltistan and Pakistan-administered Kashmir raised the issue of a worsening human rights situation in the region at the hands of Pakistani establishment and the demographic engineering due to China-Pakistan Economic Corridor infrastructure projects.
Political activists from Gilgit-Baltistan and Pakistan-administered Kashmir raised the worsening human rights situation in the region during the 43rd session of United Nations Human Rights Council in Geneva recently. Political activist from Gilgit-Baltistan, Senge S. Sering, told the council during his intervention that locals are losing battle against worse demographic engineering due to the multi-billion dollar China-Pakistan economic corridor that encourages illegal settlements of Pakistanis and Chinese. Those trying to protect natural resources in a peaceful manner are threatened with abductions, genocide and economic blockade. Sering said, China-led genocide is enabling fast depletion of flora and fauna with impending environmental catastrophe.
It's a distant dream for people of Gilgit-Baltistan who continue to face torture, sedition and terrorism charges and life imprisonment for opposing onslaught on their resources and cultural identity. Locals are losing battle against worse demographic engineering due to China-Pakistan economic corridor that encourages illegal settlements of Pakistani and Chinese citizens.
Mohammad Sajid Raja, president of Jammu Kashmir National Awami Party UK, told the council that people of Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan living under Pakistani occupation have no constitutional rights.
In Pakistani-occupied areas, people continue being subjected to arbitrary arrests, illegal detentions and enforced disappearances by the authorities.
Pakistan administers Gilgit-Baltistan without a constitutional framework and denies the locals the fundamental rights. The absence of a democratic setup causing socio-economic and political logjam has compelled locals to demand for Pakistan's withdrawal.
Nepal has temporarily suspended visa on arrival for citizens of 8 countries, including China, that have been widely affected by the deadly coronavirus or COVID-19. 4 people suspected to have contracted COVID-19 in Nepal last week have been tested negative.
Nepal government has decided to temporarily suspend visa on arrival for citizens of 8 countries, including China, that have been widely affected by the novel coronavirus. However, nationals of these 8 countries willing to visit Nepal can obtain a visa beforehand from Nepali missions abroad. The government has made it mandatory for the travelers to submit a recently issued health document certifying that they are not infected by coronavirus or COVID-19 along with their visa applications. The health certificate must be recently produced maximum 7 days earlier before the time of arrival in Nepal. Meanwhile, Nepal has also temporarily suspended all the land point of entry and exit to monitor the spread of the deadly virus. Travelers have been recommended to use the Tribhuvan International Airport, Kathmandu, as point of entry and exit until the further notice. In Nepal, 4 people suspected to have contracted the deadly virus were admitted to the isolation wards last week, but results of their tests have all been negative.
Afghan President Ashraf Ghani and rival Abdullah Abdullah took simultaneous oaths for the presidency on Monday, further plunging the war-torn country into a new political crisis. U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, reacting on this, said that U.S. strongly opposes any action to establish a parallel government and any use of force to resolve political differences.
U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, in a tweet on Tuesday, said that the U.S. strongly supports a unified and sovereign Afghanistan and opposes any effort to establish a parallel government or any use of force to resolve political differences. This comes as Ashraf Ghani was sworn in as president for a second term at a ceremony held at the presidential palace in Afghan capital Kabul. Ghani's political rival Abdullah Abdullah, who had cited fraud in electoral process in which Ghani was declared winner, also held a swearing-in ceremony for himself at Sapedar Palace on Monday. Ghani's ceremony was disrupted by the sound of rockets hitting the edge of the presidential palace compound. Ghani did not stop his speech in the midst of the rocket attack. Islamic State or Daesh claimed responsibility for the attacks. Later, U.S. Peace Envoy for Afghanistan Zalmay Khalilzad also took to Twitter and said he will continue to assist both the leaders. Khalilzad had been negotiating with the rivals to reach an amicable settlement, but efforts by the United States to resolve the crisis failed. Meanwhile, a standoff between Ghani and Abdullah threatens political chaos days after the United States and the Taliban signed a deal on the withdrawal of US-led international forces.
A 9-day fair to promote products of small and medium enterprises is attracting scores of buyers in Bangladeshi capital Dhaka. The annual fair is organized by the Bangladesh government to assist entrepreneurs in marketing their products.
A 9-day fair to promote products made in Bangladesh in both local and international markets is underway in capital Dhaka. The 8th National Small and Medium Enterprise or SME Product Fair 2020 aims at encouraging the SME products and introducing SME goods for expanding business, trade and commerce. A total of 296 small and medium enterprise entrepreneurs, including 195 women, are displaying their products like jute, agriculture and leather goods, electronics and electrical items, handicraft items at the event. Bangladeshi government has been organizing the National SME Fair to assist the small and medium enterprises in marketing their products for years now. The fair will conclude on March 12.
Department of Agriculture in India's Jammu and Kashmir region has taken a unique step to promote women empowerment in the region by training the women to cultivate mushroom, making pickles and earn money out of it.
Authorities in Kathua district of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir region have taken a unique step to promote women empowerment through skill development for self-employment. The Department of Agriculture is training women the process of mushroom cultivation, preparing mushroom pickle and how to earn money out of it.
इससे महिला बहुत खुश रह सकती है जैसे हम घर का काम खत्म करके इसके वो अचार डालने डालती हैं जैसे घर की सब्जी लगाती हैं जैसे फूल की खेती होगी जैसे सारी सब्जी घर में लगाते हैं जैसे महिला खुद का काम नहीं कर सकती हैं जी इसके साथ प्रेरित हो रही हैं कुछ आगे जाने की कोशिश कर रही हैं
According to officials, so far 20 to 25 women have participated in the drive, which will help them hone their skills. Encouraging women towards such initiatives is part of Indian government schemes that had been launched to reduce poverty among farmers and the weaker sections of the society in the country.
People across India and Nepal on Tuesday celebrated Holi, the festival of colors, by smearing each other with colors, spraying water and dancing their heart out to mark the festivities. The spring festival signifies the triumph of good over evil. It also celebrates the eternal love of Lord Krishna and his consort Radha.
Holi, the festival of colors, was celebrated across India on Tuesday with people smearing each other with colors, spraying water and dancing their heart out to mark the festivities. On the occasion, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi also wished the people of the country, saying, "Let the festival of Holi bring happiness in the lives of all countrymen." Devotees in western Ahmedabad city marked the festival by offering special prayers at the famous Jagannath temple, smearing each other with colors, flowers, and dancing to the tunes of devotional songs. Holi signifies the triumph of good over evil and also celebrates the eternal love of Hindu Lord Krishna and his consort Radha.
देखिए भगवान जगन्नाथ जी जो हैं कृष्ण के के ही अवतार हैं और कृष्ण भगवान जहां भी कृष्ण मंदिर है विष्णु मंदिर है वहां होली का आयोजन होता है और होली क्या है सभी रंगों को साथ में रख के समाज के सभी वर्गों को उल्लास के साथ में जोड़ने का काम करता है
In northern Mathura city where Lord Krishna is said to have been born people were seen soaked in colors of Holi festival Scores of devotees on the occasion also gathered at the famous Banke Bihari temple dedicated to Lord Krishna to get a glimpse of the deity on the auspicious day. Similar scenes were witnessed in other parts of the country, where people were seen dancing to the beats of celebratory music and smearing each other with colors. Meanwhile, in neighboring Nepal, people enthusiastically indulged in Holi celebrations. However, most of them chose to celebrate Holi by limiting themselves to a small group of family members, relatives and friends. Amid fears of coronavirus outbreak, the Festival of Colors, also known as Fagu Purnima in Nepal, is celebrated with merriment and joy.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/sasianewsline and follow us on Twitter @sasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.